Yeah. For everyone, the V4JS version in the server is the same that we used previously in the workshop. You don't need to change anything. Yeah. Just take the V4JS examples and the workshop V4JS games. Maybe those I just dropped away now. Okay, so I shortly want to introduce you to the example that we're working with now. It has another structure like the previous workshop, because Matthias Sauna, as you remember, he was putting everything in folders, and there was example 1 folder, example 2 folder, and so on. But here is different. We have only one example folder, and this is... I was just doing this in another way. It's a bit more like how you actually make a website if you include multiple HTML files into one index HTML. And here is there's this index HTML which looks like that. I first have to start a server as well. Okay, and I also start a server in the same way, just for everyone to repeat this practice. You have to navigate in the command line to the examples folder, V4JS examples folder, and then you type node dot dot slash www.js. Huh? Nee, das geht auch so. Ja. Server.js minus e. And now it's working. And when you have that, then you can go to localhost 5000. And now localhost 5000 is this kind of page that I copied from 3.js.
And you can get a bunch of files.
Yeah. It's not so good with the server.
The download server is hilarious, isn't
it? Okay. Wait a second.
It's 10,000 files.
Oh, yeah.
I only need the file.
Yeah, but I put it there, everything, then in case someone else needs it as well.
But you would see the others.
Okay. And this is starting. Oh, where is it?
Was ist das?
Ist das Surface 2. Das zeigt mir den Stick irgendwie nicht an.
Doch, das
war die.
Ja, der Russian. Okay.
Ah.
Das ist der Unterstrich VVVJS-Ordnung. Ist jetzt einfach drin.
Ja.
Sortiere ich mir selber.
Kein Problem. Okay, kann die Maus nicht benutzen.
Zwischenzeit.
Ja.
Ja, jetzt sind wir halt irgendwie unglaublich.
Ja?
Naja, wenn du halt nicht von den Einzeldateien
voll.
Ja.
Und, ja, hier the examples on the side, you can click it. Basically, we have a shading example later, then I will show you an example of how to use a touch thumb wheel control in the ego perspective kind of style, and instant animation. And later I will talk a lot about instancing, because this is kind of the highlight of what I put into this new WebGL node. You can do a lot of really nice stuff with very large amount of 3D models and procedural generated assets. And yeah, I will also later talk a little bit about terrain. And in the end, there is a collision detection example, which is a little bit broken, unfortunately. I couldn't push the fixes for a little bug in the collision engine, but maybe it doesn't matter. This is just to show you that there is something also in the baking. Collision detection engine for V4JS. Yeah, but probably we have enough to do with the other examples already. And maybe everyone can see if it if that works now. And yeah, let's try to arrive somewhere where everyone can run this example. Theoretically, it should work already, or no? Okay, the files are still missing. Okay, yeah, then we'll just wait. That was too fast then. Okay, it's here. You have to go here in the server, yeah?
Yeah.
Have you been there already?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. And, also. Sorry. Yeah, here. Here, it's here, V4JS Game Development.
Yeah, inside, and there are some.
And yeah, and then you just need to have basically this whole folder on your hard drive.
Yeah, but should we start this with a .js?
That is the V4JS examples. Yeah. Examples is the one that we should start with, the Node.js server, exactly. Yeah. Ah, shit, this is here. Ah, nee, genau, Workshop Games. Yeah. Genau, und dann, just for explanation, the Workshop Games folder is not so primary here. I put it for you in the folder, because these are my exporters that I used to create the assets that we're going to work with in VVVV. So this is a bunch of VVVV modules and patches that export, that convert meshes into the format that we use in V4JS, and that can export things like transformation data for use in instancing. So we can, for example, with these exporters, we can create a level in VVVV based on a lot of spreads and whatever we can do there. And then we can export this data as a scene file. And the scene file can be read in V4JS. Fertig, ja? Okay. Yes. Ah, you haven't been in the first virtual. Yeah, he will explain it to you. But you just need to finish the next. Or maybe I shortly boost you there. Also für alle nochmal, um diesen Server zu starten, muss man diesen Befehl eingeben. Ja? Und zwar muss man den eingeben, nachdem man zu dem entsprechenden Folder navigiert ist, in dem die Examples liegen. Das ist in dem Fall... Sorry. Yeah, okay. So, again, to make the server run, you have to navigate to that folder, V4JS examples, in your command prompt. So, you go like, basically, like you go with cd, and then, you have to navigate your file system until you are in VVVJS examples, yeah? And once you are there, you just need to type this. And then it should work. What it means is that in your V4JS example, Node opens up a server based on the script that is placed in this folder, v4.js server.js.
But do we have to install a server first?
Yeah, I think with npm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but you only have to install once, of course. Yeah. Oh.
Ja, das ging uns ein, so.
Ah, okay.
Deswegen die USB.
Ja, okay. Who has no files yet? Workshop files. Everyone has the workshop files. You not? Okay, then the USB stick should go to you next. Yeah. Where is the USB stick? Ah, yeah. Here. Yeah, and who has the server running already? Who has the server running? Okay, that's like almost more than half of the people. Yeah, and so should I start making a little bit the actual workshop part, or should we still wait a little bit? Who is completely lost? No one? Yeah. Okay, then, so now this is just the index HTML and it's basically the overview, it's not where we're gonna work. For working, we can navigate those examples separately by just going to 01.html, for example, is the first one, 02 is the second one, then it opens in full screen. And there we can open up the patch. In the previous one, you can't open up the patch because it's basically embedded. I like it. And the patch is called root cook torrents. That's a bit unintuitive, but on the other hand, I also didn't want to make it easier for you because the patches folder here, here that's basically my game engine library that I provide you in the workshop, and it sums up the most common things that I was developing for game engine related stuff or for WebGL in one place, so you don't have to switch between folders too much. There you can also see, for example, if we are in this. I mean, I just want to make sure there's this relation of we have here 01.html opened, and apparently this is 01.html. So if we want to know what is the name of the patch, we just need to open this and have a look here. And apparently the patch that runs is root cooktorrents.v4p, and that's what we can open up by making hash edit slash patches slash root cooktorrents.v4p.
The part after the patch edit needs to be the exact complete path and then the state of the HTML file.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so now I do this, I click enter, and then the patch opens. And we can see how it looks. There's some unnecessary stuff here also.
David?
Yep.
Can you quickly show the update?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. And now we are directly into this new CookTorrents shader node. And everyone who knows V4 know that the standard shader always was this Phong directional, for example. But these are super old lightning equations that do not provide much realism. And in recent years, the so-called image-based lighting got kind of widespread, and especially was not so hard for me to find WebGL sources that I could port to V4JS so that we have a little bit of a better shader that can do a lightning model that is based on the roughness and Fresnel refraction and refraction parameters. So you can define your materials with this roughness here, for example. So you can make it very shiny, or you can make it very rough. And several other parameters that you can make the shader look more like glass, or more like other materials. You have refraction is like light passing through, and I mean, this is just something to play around. If you want to make a nice rendering in WebGL, now it's totally possible with V4JS, and the only thing that you need to do is to make a geometry file that you a geometry that you can actually load, and I'm really wondering how many people are into shader coding here? And also then probably you know how geometry works, and I just want to show here shortly in this workshop, in this V4JS workshop files, I think it has another name in use, where the V4 patches is, there's this mesh exporter here. With that you can convert all your meshes into a format that is readable from V4JS. I just started shortly. Slow. Yeah, he can show you. Yeah, and the patch. Yeah, you need to append only this to your URL. And the rest Matthias is going to show you. Yeah. Starts really long. Ah, okay. Okay, everyone, now we have V4 open, not V4JS, and simply to show you, okay, you can import meshes into V4 in the normal way as you know it, And then you can use my exporter writer JSON geometry to make a JSON geometry out of it. That's all. And in this case, we just use the T-port and export it. And then we can put it into the folder. In this case, I put it here in patches, models. And I put it in patches because patches you can directly access in the file path. That means I just have to type models, because models is in patches, you know? So that makes things easier. You don't need to have complicated file paths. So I just put here the teapot, one second. Mesh.json is our teapot. And I could put it to models. Mesh.json is already there. And I type mesh, and then we have a teapot here. So that it's basically just a JSON format which contains vertex data and index data. And it doesn't even contain normal data or texture coordinates right now. But that you could just easily add. It's like you just have to insert a string basically, and then, yeah. You also have to do the same in the input in the geometry file node, but yeah, this will come later. We will update this again. And right now the normals are built on the fly. So I did this because when you're in the web, you want to have your files as small as possible. So what you can do with complex geometry is you just use the thing that you really need, which is vertices and indices, and you just skip the normals and you just skip the texture coordinates, and you build the normals on the fly while you load it. And this way you can have very complicated meshes that still load quick enough in the web. But yeah, this is just a small detail on the side.
And you do it in this mesh node, geometry
file node. Yeah, genau, this is just doing this, yeah.
Okay. Face normals or?
Yeah, smooth normals.
Okay.
Yeah. And down here, this is some standard stuff that you encounter in V4 also sometimes.
This is screen info, so of course
no. Ah, genau, screen info. Genau. Yeah, I mean, this is something that you can just look at it at home when you want to set up a 3D environment that is interactive. You need you don't have a classical camera node like in V4, so you still need to feed the view and the projection into the render more or less manually, and for that you also need to make the aspect ratio manually, and for that we have this screen info node, which gives information about the resolution in pixels of the renderer. And yeah, you can do the scale accordingly and everything. It's kind of self-explanatory when you go through it.
So what David is doing here is dynamically scanning the render to the actual browser.
Yeah.
So it's using screen info node, which gives him the visible area, and then he takes this dimensions and just feeds it into the back bar.
Yeah. Here you see that I get these values. And according to this, with a simple map that you probably all can follow, I just adjust the perspective scale and the width and the height of the renderer. And this way it's always scaling with the browser window. Yeah. And I mean this. Okay, now. Let's go to instancing directly. Let's get really advanced. Now you have a good rendering, and most of you might know that with the classical approach in VVVV for making many objects on the screen, we use just a spreading and put it into transform nodes, and then it makes many objects, and you see here in a bracket that you have now 100 objects down there in the bracket transform out, and when you want to make like 2000 objects, it gets really laggy already. So we don't like this too much, and we can't really do that. And everyone who is who is fluid already with DirectX 11 knows instancing. It turned out this is also possible in WebGL nowadays. So I implemented a system how you can use the instancing in WebGL. And that means you can make super many instances. So we can, instead of having lags after 1000 objects, we can use the instancer node, and we can make 500,000 teapots or ape heads, and it runs super smoothly. That is not everything. You can even define many attributes for every instance individually, so that you can make very you can basically upload very less data to the GPU and create super many instances, and it's very powerful. I will show you how that can be set up. So first, we will get rid of this. Theoretically, like this, no? So, and I put this a bit aside. So, and now we can call up the instancer node. And this node has a geometry input. It has especially, it's a dynamic instancer node. This is not the same instancer node like in DirectX 11. It's a completely another thing, basically. It wraps all the instancing functionality in one node. In DirectX 11, it's more like there are a lot of different small nodes that do things, but no one really know how to use them properly together. And here we can do things like this. I'll just open this a little bit up here. Count. Here's the geometry input. So it doesn't work anymore. Yeah, that doesn't work. The point is, we need another shader now. In order the shader that we're gonna use is the Phong directional instanced. I just prepared that already. I will show later what's different in this shader. Or maybe I will even explain it right away, because it kind of makes sense. If we go to V4JS effects, and then we go into Phong directional instanced, we see here um, attributes. And here's this attribute, which is an offset, and this offset is a positional offset. So what you do with instancing, basically, you render all instances on one position, and with the offset vertex attribute, you can change the position for every instance. And usually, vertex attributes without instancing, they are per vertex of the mesh. But with instancing, if you define the instancing of a certain vertex attribute, then it's not per vertex anymore, but per instance. That means you can, for example, make every instance another color by feeding this buffer of color values inside the instance. So what we have to do now is this semantic here is offset, and now the instancer defines the offset vertex attribute as instanced, and we can use it here in the shader. After that, we can do anything with offset, like with a normal shader. Just it applies per instance and not per vertex. And what else do we have here? Instance divisor, we can now just don't think about it too much, but later I explain it. And here is a buffer. And with that, we come to the buffer nodes that I wanted to explain. We can use a buffer. Game buffer value. I have this game category now. We have. You can always type game, and there's all the stuff that I developed in this a game library, basically. And one thing is that we have buffers. We can connect this buffer here. This away. And yeah, basically, I can put. Maybe I just put everything here away. I don't need it right now anymore. Just adding a little bit clutter. So, buffer. And this buffer has a vector size. So you can make one-dimensional buffers, two, three, and four-dimensional buffers, but not more. Because vertex attributes are limited to four values. And there's also apply, and a vector, and now, theoretically, it works. So now we have a slightly different thing. Oh.
I think I broke it yesterday.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So, the only thing that you need for instancing is you put an instancer node in between the geometry file and the shader. And you need in the instancer node, you need to write the semantic that you want to instance, or let's say the name of the vertex attribute. And in the shader, you just need to add this vertex attribute, like a normal vertex attribute, like position, texture, coordinates, and normals are standard. And here you can do anything. You can call it offset, but you can also call it funny colors, whatever. It's just this is just the way how you get the instance data inside of there. And the next thing is, now you have this count, and we can now start making spreads. Like, for example, I make a typical array of let's try if we can make this happen. And I need to also specify how many are there, so I use a count node and give this to the count. And now there are very much it's now let's say 300.
Sorry?
Yes? One second. I just want to. Yeah. Okay. Now we have instancing working. Okay. What should I explain again? Ah. Okay. Yeah. You don't need to add it. You just need to use the Phong directional instance shader. Yeah, and in that one I added already this one, this line that I have marked there, Felix. You just need to add another vertex attribute. Oh, okay, yeah, okay. And this is now already prepared for you, but if you want to make your own shaders, and I mean, now we just started using instancing, but it can do much more than only that. This is the apply pin, by the way. Apply pin is important because just like in DirectX 11, when you apply it all the time, it's slow. It uploads basically to the GPU. And also, you always have to note my little surface here is also super weak, but. It has only an Intel HD 4500 graphic chip, but it can already in WebGL make 4069 instances of a vertex, which is not too bad. On your rendering machine at home, you can easily make 800,000 instances, no problem.
Can you let's see if I answer.
Yeah. It's basically you render all the instances in one draw call, and before you have to make one draw call per so this is effectively in the V4JS renderer a very long for loop when you don't do instancing. Now it's only one draw call. And okay. Does someone have questions so far for that now? Does it work? Does someone try to copy it and it works, or does it not work, or something like that? Okay. Yeah, just watching is also okay in this workshop, because I expect already that at one point I will lose half of you with patching or shader, or there will be always something that is a bit new. It's totally good. Okay, now I want to go one step further, because this is what basically people do nowadays a lot in DirectX 11.
One question is, yeah. The offset is scalable, so I can
exactly. That's the next thing. Yeah, you can make multiple vertex attributes.
Yes.
Yeah, and that is easy as that. Let's say I will just present it shortly. in the next example. I will not make it live now, then it's easier. Because okay, in the next example we basically just use the instancer node to play back animations that I generated with VVVV. And so it's basically it's like this kind of funny insects and people doing animations. They were procedural generated, and I have prepared that file already. You have to type patches root underscore instance animation dot v4p to open the patch. And here we see how it's possible to spread the vertex attributes and to use basically an unlimited amount of vertex attributes. In that case, this is really something I will just explain. And maybe it takes a while, but when it's clear later, then you will probably understand how versatile the instancing actually can be.
Is input pins in the instancer?
Yeah.
We are created because methods.
No. No. That is. So when I open the instancer node, you have this input count pin. Yeah, and when you want one vertex attribute, you can leave it to one. But when you want to have two vertex attributes, you can put it to two. And then it adds a new. Wait, it should. Didn't it just do it? No. Or maybe it only works if it's connected. Yeah, why isn't it working? It should totally do that. But here, for example. Here I have 9 inputs, and when I make 10, then I should at least get. Yeah, now it's get. You see, it's adding more pins, and it's adding more buffer pins, especially. But we just need 9 for that. And okay, I will explain this patch now from top to down because there's a lot of new stuff. First of all, we have this scene file, and. The scene file is just a JSON file that can store values, all kind of values. Most likely position values if you want to distribute objects, but it can be color and it can be transformation values. This scene file here, there's also a new data type, it's a scene object. And here I have this specialized node for my purpose of this animation that just unpacks the scene into all the vertex attributes that we need. And in this case here, I wanted to put transformations in the shader as vertex attributes. Now it turns out this is not possible because transformations are, this is a matrix, right? Yeah, the transformation is always a matrix of 4x4 values. Yeah, and you can maximum put 4 values in a vertex attribute. So what I needed to do is I splitted up the transformations that were created in VVVV into their 4 components. First row, the second row, the fourth row, and so, yeah, and these four rows. And this is what is here going in the shader. TM1 is transformation matrix 1, and transformation matrix 2, transformation matrix 3 and 4. And then I have color, and I have model matrix 1, model matrix 2, model matrix 3 and 4. Yeah. First is the transformation matrix. Is the... Wait a second. Transformation matrix is the transformation of the all the in, wait, I think I will explain it differently because I well, you see the one character, okay? One character is composed out of 40 spheres. Yeah. So this is this instancer divisor parameter. You can say, okay, you want from the first buffer, you want to use it 40 times. Yeah. Also, you want to use the per one buffer value for 40 instances. Yeah. So basically, what I do here for transforming these characters, I put 40 spheres on one point. And this is what happened here. So so they can, you can randomize them here. That was maybe not so good. You know, like. You can change the positions of every character, okay? But what you actually do is you just change the position of 40 spheres on top of each other. And then after you made this, you can define another transformation that makes the topology of this model. Yeah, so... yeah, this may be now a bit complicated. I wonder if I can show this shortly a bit better. Yeah, so, okay, again, I try to sum it up. What you see here is every of this creature is not a model at all. It's not a model, it's just 40 spheres. And all and the first thing that I do here is to make 40 spheres on different positions with a translate and a rotate, so they all can turn around, you know, like this. This is basically the world transform of all the model, so and it applies for 40 instances at once. And at that point, everything would be just 40 balls on one point. But then, once it's transformed in the world, I can use this animation buffer to put them, put the spheres apart from each other, and to transform them and scale them in a way that they make up the arms and the head, something like that. I can play back an animation that I stored in this scene file.
So yeah. Get matrix buffers, your helper node, which yeah. Just splits up the regular transformation.
Exactly.
Four vectors.
Yeah.
And because these are the world transformations, and they apply to 40 spheres.
Yeah.
We have these
14
size.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So you have you can say, okay, you have in total 15 characters. So you just need to have 15 transforms feeding into this instancer node. While you have 15 multiple 40 animations coming out of here, but you don't see it because it's everything handled under the hood. And so then this way it's very it's kind of performative. You don't have to deal with big spread sizes, but anyway you can upload a large amount of data to the GPU. Yeah, because once you have spread again, when the spread is large again, it gets also slow, kind of. Here in this scene nodes, everything is handled as JavaScript array, and partly also as raw data. So it's faster, basically. For example, here's somewhere this color in between. Yeah, the color. Here comes color inside. We can also make the color manually. Buffer. And this must be a 4D vector. And you see, everything stops. It's really like the instancer is when the attributes are not correctly fitted in the instancer, it doesn't work. So when there is like too much values going in the instancer or too less values going in the instancer, it doesn't work. So you have to be careful to make sure that what you feed in is actually corresponding with the count and with the instance divisor. So for example, when I have count 60, but instance divisor for the first vertex attribute is 40, that means I need 600 is the count here. And if I make 600 divided by fifteen. I just wanted to prove that this is everything. Divide by 40, then you have 40. Hello. Yeah. Okay, but it's like that, but I can theoretically should work again once I feed here 600 inside and apply the buffer. Where's the supply button again?
Ich habe eine Interface-Frage, wenn ich es nicht mehr da oben mache. Ich kann da reinschreiben.
Ja. Okay, you see, now I did here basically 600. Okay, so this is the color. I just make a classical linear spread in the R value of the color. Yeah. No, the bin size of the color is 1. Yeah. No, it's always 1. But I can make it to 40. And then I just need to put 15 there. When you want to edit such spreaded I/O boxes, yeah, you have to go in the inspector and go to input value, and then we can make this color to 40, and then we need to make here basically 15, and now everyone has another color. It's just not so extremely visible. Maybe let's make another. a thing here, like this. Okay, you see now we have like for every character one color. Sorry? No, it works, it's just not so nicely visible because I only do it with red and blue. It's RGB. A. Yeah. Then you have to calculate the HSV somehow, but right now it's only RGBA.
What ranges are these colors? Are 0 to 1 or is it
0 to 1 actually? That's a good point, yeah. Yeah, now it's more visible, yeah? And now we can go in disco mode. Yeah. And now this is actually how InstaSync is used at all. Like it's really powerful in games. They use it make a geometry that has like 60 different vertex attributes, and they use it in a way that they don't upload much data at once. How it's used most of the time right now in DirectX 11 is kind of wrong, because everyone does just like put a huge spread inside and upload it, and it takes really long to upload it, and you cannot really update it in real time. But in games, you need to update things always in real time. And you can do this really nicely with instancing and different vertex attributes. In the end, you could even do super advanced stuff like something like multiplexing vertex attributes, theoretically. And then you can reduce your buffer count extremely, but you have a huge amount of instances. For one example would be if you want real-time crash, you can make a really small buffer with all the crash piles at the positions that you wanted, but at these positions you render every time like already 500 crash on one point, and then with another vertex attribute you can distribute a noise kernel, or you can just feed a buffer with noise values inside, and you can kind of pick from this small buffer randomly, and this way you can make a huge field of crash with only a tiny handful of incoming buffer values. And also with these characters, it's the same basically, yeah. And you could think not characters, but you could think grass, buildings, vegetation, which brings me to the next example. Yeah. Sorry?
The scene file also contains the creature versions.
Yeah, the scene file, that's a good point. Let's discuss that shortly. And maybe at this point I can show you the thesis. There must be somewhere here. Thesis. And the thesis was basically not so much about V4JS, but procedural generation of isometric role-playing games. But I used this time to make a lot of V4JS, and in the end it was more V4JS than any procedural generation. This is the wrong... No. I wonder why is there no scrolling wheel here. Oh, Scene file here. So, this is basically how the scene file looks inside, and it's a very loose thing that I just use for myself, and you can decide yourself if you want to use it in the same way or come up with a completely other idea. My idea was just that you can store buffers, like arrays of values, in a JSON format, and store multiple of these buffers with different names. So it's completely arbitrary. The only thing that you always have to design is the offset count ID, and then you give the buffer value. And the offset count ID means basically from this little list you can reconstruct sub buffers. Like for example, the ID could refer to the ID of a tree, a procedure generated tree or a character, and the ID 20 starts at buffer offset 0 and has only count 1, so only the first buffer value would be used for the ID 20. In case of this scene file, that must be also somewhere here. Animation data. Yeah. In this case, it's the same principle, but I even extended. I just write all the JSON like that I need in the buffer myself, and you can read it out with JavaScript. You can just pass the JSON file and get it in the positions that you wanted. And it's maybe. So this is the basic, and I have also the exporters there in the, you can just look it up when you really need. Let's say now it's maybe a bit too complicated to completely get into this JSON parsing and things like that, but let's say when you need it, you can just open the examples and see, this is the exporter for animation or for the vegetation example, and then I think it should be possible that you understand it and reverse engineered. Yeah.
I don't want to dig too deep.
Yeah. Right now, the JSON is actually a standard format for WebGL already. Yeah. Yeah, an animation. Depends what comes along. I always just develop for the use case that I just have, and I also don't like so much to go back to very old standards like the Collada and try to squeeze them into JavaScript. No. Ah, okay. Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's cool. Yeah, maybe this could be also implemented with the Node.js findings. Yeah, for sure, yeah. Yeah, but in that case, I mean, the basic idea is that you want to have the spreads from V4 in V4.js. And the best way to do this is really to go with JSON and to just pack it eventually also into a little sub spreads in one buffer. And especially if you want to use it in instancing, then that makes also sense. And then at that point, maybe shortly, while I have this open already, it's just. Sorry, I was searching something. Yeah. I mean, I was experimenting with these game engine stuff and arrive at visuals like that. And a working prototype that I can also show you now. Yeah, and it can be also clicked together with the nodes that are there right now. But it was hard to set up the examples in a way that everyone can still follow me, which is probably still hard. And at the same time, to show how to put whole game prototype together was a bit too much. So I just give you these examples, and theoretically you can put it together in a way like they're going to show you now. I mean, I will also show later the terrain stuff, and that is really nice. These experiments that I made with V4 and V4.js showed me that it's kind of powerful to use VVV for creating the assets and use V4.js as the client for a game. And yeah, most likely it's still a prototype because, I mean, theoretically it's possible to put it on Android, and Matthias and me also tested it already. You could walk on an Android device with 1 GHz of processor power and a crappy GPU in a 3D world with thumb feel control. That was not bad. It was kind of promising already, and and now with the networking nodes, we can also prototype little multiplayer games, and it's kind of cool. And just a question where this graphic is and that I actually want to show. Here somewhere. Change for now. Game runtime. Maybe I go. And then, I want to get a little bit away from the V4.js because it's pretty complicated and this instancing was probably a bit overkill for you, but I hope you kind of still get the vibe a little bit that you can put a lot of vertex attribute inside and you can make many, many models with a nice shading if you want. But now I want to give you a bit of a bigger picture. What I was working on in the master thesis, the division of these two things working together, V4 as procedural content generation for the assets. And this is here with this slightly blue background color and exchange formats with the green background color and the game runtime. And in this little flow graph, we can see how this can all work together. Every box is basically a patch that can make basically the continent and like procedural generate the continent and export a large amount of heat map data that you can use later for working on it. And the terrain generator can fill this large data with water and trees and little buildings and things like that. And the level generator can make such roguelike levels or something like that. It's really easy with V4. You just need rule-based systems that you make, like typically spreads, and you make a random spread, and then it randomly changes your rules. And basically, in procedural content generation, there's always the terms of there are different types of procedural content generation, and one thing that we can do very good with V4 is constraint-based and rule-based generators. Constraint-based is typically when you have a random spread and it's from -1 to 1, then the constraint is -1 to 1, and within this, is in this parameter space, you can generate the different positions, for example. And then you can make, then you can patch a building, and some part of the patch that makes your building can be randomly controlled, and by iterating through these random seeds, you can export 100 different buildings, and then save everything in one scene file, and then basically quickly make a procedural generated city that you can walk in V4.js. This is still not so easy, but theoretically it's already possible. Together with these physics nodes. And you can imagine all kind of generators that V4 can do, and since the scene file is so flexible, it just takes different values, and you just need to name those values. And actually, you have here a string coming out that just show what's the name of these values. It's no spread, it's a bit buggy here. And these are basically the then you can access it with this animation buffer or scene nodes. There's also this element buffer. You can, for example, I will show this in the next example. This is a bit better. You can actually go there now. Because why I want to show the next example is it's using exactly the same principle like for the characters, but for plants. Just the let's say the morphology of the transformation is different. And we have billboards for leaves. They are not the most beautiful trees, but they're also not so bad, and they kind of do their job. And you could easily keep that together. And that's basically always what makes all this possible is this scene manager kind of component of the engine. And the buffers that you get from the scene, you can always use them for the graphics, which is the most obvious thing, but you can also use them for the collision engine. something that I'm gonna show shortly in the end. So let's open this root instant vegetation we for patch. What's going on here is it's everything in a subpatch, that's why it's a bit more tidy. And the subpatch only takes a position buffer and the indices. And the indices in this case are the index of the tree. Like, for example, if they're all the same, then it should be all the same. Yeah. No, it's not true. Nah, it's a bit more complicated actually. In these examples, I really just try to push the limit of this instancing and try to how far can I go with buffers and sub-buffers and frames, different frame-based animations. And yeah, here this botany buffer is the same like the animation buffer, but instead of in the animation, I was just in VVVV, I was sampling the walking animation in every frame. So you have like 24 frames, and every frame is in the scene file a list of values. And here it's the same, just that it's not sampled as an animation, but it's randomly sampled. So you have species of trees and individuals of trees. So you have X amount of species and X amount of individuals. And with this selector here, it's possible to select a different animation. They're still called animations, but they are basically the species. And within the species, you can use the time. Obviously, I first made the animation node. And then you can randomly make different morphology of this tree. It's basically the same. Just this time I made it a bit easier. Instead of using a transformation matrix for the global transform for every tree, I used this offset again that I showed in the beginning. So it's only one buffer going inside here. Randomly, and
no transform
exactly, and the only transform is the transform for the individual model matrix exactly.
And one matrix will also just be parking or applying this for some generation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. You can instead of using these buffers that I stored in the scene file, you can also make them with set mate like get matrix. This one. And you can make. Yeah, if you make a patch that makes trees, you can also do that in real time. Yeah, but right now I had the patch that makes the trees, that is in VVVV.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have transformation on the y-axis for
Yeah, that would be totally possible. Yeah. That is totally easy, yeah. You can do that with that stuff. Yeah. Ah, yeah, these connections you cannot really split up. Yeah, this is a good question. You would do it differently. You would not like classical before. You would take the connection and open it up and do something with it and close it again. But you cannot do this here because in instancing you work with larger amount of values and it gets really slow if you do that. So what you would do is you would make it in the shader. So you would kind of need to make a new vertex attribute that makes, for example, a scale. Scale in Y, and then you multiply it in the vertex shader. Yes, exactly. There is. You can also make instance ID. For example, you can simply feed in an I spread as a vertex buffer and then makes an instance ID. You can do things like that. And then this botany buffer also give out a billboard buffer. It's just the position of all the billboards. Like, where are the leaves? And yeah, there's a billboard shader. This example also shows very nicely how versatile the instancing can be. When you combine multiple models together, for example, this side here makes the branches with this kind of 15 cylinder are making one tree, and on the other side you have the billboards and you have always 8 billboards on one tree. And as you notice, all the trees have different billboards, yeah? And it works like this.
You're talking about the leaves.
The leaves, billboards, yeah. Sorry, this is something else. In textures, you have this billboard texture atlas, like all the different leaves in one place. Now what I do here is I have this index, and this is the index of which billboard to use. Yeah, and I use it 8 times also in the instance divisor, so that when I give here a 0 in the first value, then it takes the 0 for 8 instances. That means they have all the same leaf, this one. And in shader, in the shader it looks like this. So you have also these instant vertex attributes that we defined here, like offset, leaves, index and scale, yeah, here. They are here. And this is how you make the model matrix, or how you make the matrix from this transform again, from the offset. yeah, I mean, here goes into shader coding. I will not go too much into that. If you want to do something there, you just open it up and you fiddle around with this WebGL code. It's not so much different than HLSL from DirectX 11. It's just like tiny, a little bit different. So no worries there. But here, what I want to show is the only thing. Yeah, this line of code is used to define from this index value the respective texture coordinates to sample the texture from the atlas. Yeah, and this is super powerful. Also, you can not only make a small atlas like I did there, but you can make large atlases and you can make a huge cloud of images in the web this way. I think you can do things like render 20,000 images in real time, different images, by using multiple large texture atlases. For example, maximum of texture atlases is 16,000 by 60,000 pixels. You could, for example, use 8 of them, and then you have a lot of different images stored in the texture atlases, and then you can use them in real time already. System. Yeah. That's also what they usually do in games as well. Like, there are a lot of sprites and a lot of fog effects and far away vegetation is also rendered as billboards, and there are billboards everywhere. So it's also a good example for games. Yeah.
So let's say you want to do instancing, but completely generate all the data in 4GS.
Yeah.
What would it be initially making huge spreads? Mm-hmm. Do we apply somewhere and then increase decrease the spread constantly?
That would be possible, but the best way would always be to make to program specific nodes for that with your dynamic node, for example. Because I had the experience that when you handle the instancing, it's best to always stick to JavaScript arrays and not to start with the spreads. Well, you said once that spreads are basically internally handled as JavaScript arrays, but anyway, also I found sometimes. Yeah, I mean, it's also possible, but the best is really to go for this kind of fast nodes. Yeah, okay. And has someone question to this example? Anyone? We have 1.5 hour left, or 5:30. 5 is finished, and now it's 4. Or 5:30 is finished. Yeah. Yeah? Yeah. Exactly. There's in this vegetation, botany instance, yeah, there's a there's a deformation going on. Yeah, with a fractional Brownian motion noise. It's also a nice reference to dig out, actually. Let's look at this shortly. I always like the syntax highlighting here more. This one, oh. Don't like the skin. Usually I have dark colors. Here you have this FBM stuff that I adapted from EQ, makes shader toys. And here also you see, just again, you remember we feed these model, these MM1, MM2, MM3, MM4 model matrices here inside as four pins here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and you can construct a transform in the shader from it. And then this way you can bypass the problem that you cannot put transforms in the vertex attributes. The noise is simply applied to the position here. It's applying a fractional Brownian motion to the position, and then that's it. And so that's how I made these three move a little bit around. You know, they're a little bit animated. That one you see. From close it looks not really good, but my prototype was an isometric game, and it doesn't matter. I can show you shortly. Yeah. That's how everything looks when it's put together. Well, that's a prototype. You can walk around and there are these little hitboxes around. And you can shoot off. And they hit also here. It goes through the terrain, unfortunately, right now. But yeah, it's already a lot of fun.
It still isn't attacking you. It still isn't attacking you, even though you shot it.
Sorry?
Der Gegner greift dich nicht an und rührt ihn ab.
Yeah, no, there's not much logic behind it. I was mostly focusing that I could really put everything together and you can walk on the terrain. Later you could add AI to it and you could make game-related things, like you can do hack and slay and then you drop items and you level up and things. That's actually the easy part doing that. And it's actually not so optimal. Because my controls are really crappy here. I didn't work much on this control. But this brings me to the terrain, and this is actually this terrain is 1 million square kilometer large. So it was like an extreme test case for the master thesis. So you can like go really far, and but probably at one point there will be some issues. It's right now running on the Surface 2. It's running on the Surface 2 with an Intel HD 4500 graphic chip, and it's a little bit laggy, but it's totally fine on a proper PC. Yeah, but this will be not running anymore in a Android device, of course. Yeah, you have this funny world, and we can also go inside and fly around in 3D. Oh yeah, and we can have a look at the patch, because it's not so crazy as you would think. Now it's everything you saw already, just not the terrain stuff. I have here this dynamic terrain module. And yeah, once you get the flow, it's always the same. Like either you do instancing or you do these heat maps. And for the heat maps, I build a little node set. Every time you type terrain, there will be terrain grid, which makes the dynamic grid in the world. So while you move, it loads the new terrain patches, and the other one are discarded. And you have terrain collision, so that you always have for every heat map, you can make a scene file that contains the heat of every vertex of this terrain patch. And that scene file you can use as a buffer for the terrain collision. And then you can you just need to put position of your character and the buffer of the terrain, and then it will give you a heat value. And this way you can already easily walk there. These are all the very, very basics of game engines. And they are not very much optimized. Sometimes I try to make it a bit faster, but there's much for improvement, much space for improvement to make it faster. And right now it's just like, yeah, it's hardly working, basically. And the stuff is missing still. Anyway, and you have a terrain picking. With that you can cast a ray on the terrain. And that's what I used for this. You can click somewhere and it walks somewhere, yeah. There are two terrain collision, okay. Well, I think the game ones are the new ones, but I think I have to make new naming convention. That's a bit messy here. Okay, anyway. Let's just shortly see here. There's this terrain grid, and here you have a camera position, and according to where the camera position is, it loads different indices. It gives out different indices. It's basically just a logic. Like, you have to move a grid of 3x3 patches over a plane. Yeah. Yeah. This is. I didn't update that yet. Here you have the collision engine as a module, and inside that you have like. You have this element buffers which takes the terrain values, and a picking node for the raycast to pick from the terrain, and you have even a move node. You have a terrain collision node, and for the shooting of the balls you have a trajectory node, a collision box sweep. So it's basically it's a very basic 3D collision algorithm that is used everywhere, and it's just packed into this node. Yeah, all these nodes are not so much small nodes like we usually used to have everything small and modular, but in this game engine field I think there are many complicated algorithms that need larger nodes, basically, that wrap everything, and you can just forget about a complicated algorithm and access the few parameters as you need them. This way it actually works nicely. Visual programming with game engine focus is maybe not too stupid idea. And here you have vegetation and characters. What you saw, these are the example patches that I gave you. And here's a huge mess with the camera, basically. And there we can have some fun. And just make a fly-through, basically. You have crazy glitches if you do it like this. Yeah, so you could make this kind of 90s style flight simulators, and if you polish a little bit, probably you could arrive at a pretty decent graphic even. Oh. Okay. So, but now I want to go back to localhost 5000 to this terrain. You might notice that the thumb wheel joystick is buggy once you rescale the page. So, for example, now it's okay, you can move up and down, but when you make it smaller, then suddenly it goes crazy because it didn't update the correct screen size. So, okay, this terrain is based on. There is also the exporter in here, this terrain export, and I don't even want to open it because actually this is something you could really do alone and check it out at home. But it produces this format. It produces a lot of little heat maps for using as for the GPU for displacement mapping. And it has these scene files. And they contain the same. So the it's also not so optimal, but the PNGs contain basically the height values for the GPU, and the scene files contain the height values for the CPU for collision detection. It's the same data, yeah. Yeah, I was also, in the next step, I would skip these PNGs and just use the JSON files and upload them to the mesh. But right now it's like that. And it's also a very primitive logic behind how this loading is made now. Okay, let's see. Look, there's one thing with this terrain that is really troublesome, and this is cracks between patches. You see those little cracks here, where you see underneath the terrain? Yeah. When you usually export the PNGs and you try to arrange them in a grid to make a terrain out of multiple patches, then you have these cracks. And only the fact that I was spending 3 months trying to fix cracks is that you are now able to use it without cracks, and because the logic is kind of you always have to crop away, you have to sample the height map with 1 pixel offset so that you have 1 pixel that you don't use later, because at this pixel you have on the edge you have interpolation in the pixel shader, and then now this way it doesn't happen, and you can also see in the exporter what I did in the exporter to avoid this, the logic is actually just like this. We have 9 patches, also 9 terrain patches, 3x3. And this terrain grid node calculates where are the current patches and which index do they have. So you can use the cam position directly with a frame delay. Here this must should be that one. And bring it up there and then there. And then was it wrong now kind of? Ah, this is this needs something like a minus one or something like that. Ah, yeah. So, what happens now, it's just the terrain like move with us, yeah? Oh, there's a bug. I don't know how this... I don't know how this happens. Now there are still cracks. Naja, but not so much. Cracks. I hate cracks. I was solving cracks so long. Anyway, this... world grid resolution, say we have 8x8 height maps, so it makes the indices for the files, and these indices, as you see while we move through the world, those indices here change here, and now even we are out of this grid already. Then we simply load those textures for the height map. So we format a string, and here you see always while we move, it changed the string. Have a look at this. So then it changed to a new string, and it does it in a way that it keeps the old ones. Because, you know, when we usually do such thing in VVVV, patch-based, the spread order always change. And then it has to load all at once, yeah, and this is really annoying, and so this is why I needed to write this node, the terrain grid. I needed to write this terrain grid in order that the spread order doesn't change. And it always takes away the one that are not there anymore, and spread indices, it puts the new index. And this way we can kind of make sure that when you move along the world and behind you, you don't need three patches anymore. Only they disappear, and in front of you, only the new one appear, and the old one stay the same. The same we could do now, because now this is now only the hate map. We cannot walk on this yet. Yeah, it has no collision detection, but you should just show how it works. And here there are here are positions coming out. 9x3 positions. Makes sense, no? And these are just used in the transformation. Just here, it's everything standard. There's also no instancing involved or something like that. Instancing doesn't necessarily make sense here because it's only 9 patches. It's okay if we have 9 draw calls for that. And now we could try to figure out how we can walk on this terrain. And for this, we can load the scene file with the scene file node. And here, now we have 9 scenes. And they are also objects. I didn't want to be that string or value, because the objects, they are the JavaScript arrays. And they are fast. But we can not access them so easy. We can also, now we just need to use the terrain collision. And make element buffer. Because with this element buffer, the scenes contain scene elements. And with this selector on the element buffer, we can select those elements. And here, for example, we can see what is actually inside the scene. We have basically 9 times terrain for all these 9 scenes. Everyone has terrain inside, so we write here terrain. It could also be that it's not only terrain inside, but also terrain and trees and buildings. But if we want from this scene only the terrain, then we have to write and specify here terrain. And then we have the element buffer giving us theoretically the buffer, or practically it says undefined. Okay, wait a second. No, it just needs to be connected somewhere. Okay. Now we have 9 buffers, and every buffer is containing all height values for the corresponding terrain patch. And now we have this terrain collision node. Yeah, then we have to see what are the input values for this. It has position XYZ. That's the position that you want to check for the collision. You have grid positions and grid indices. The grid, that's a bit misleading, but this is the world grid that is specified from the terrain grid here, okay? Grid position gets this grid position here. And grid index gets this grid index. And grid scale gets grid scale, of course. Yeah, and I just erase this, make it a bit more readable. This is just a helper where I want later want to attach the collision, and then we want to prove that it moves. And I'm not sure if really this example is now going to work, because I have already the feeling that it's going to be this kind of forfeit effect, but let's see. Okay, now we have the positions, and maybe we can use the camera position here as well. And use a bit more, because this is also spreadable, of course. This was the wrong cluster. So, camera position plus. I just make this kind of carpet of bubbles now that should move over the terrain. That's just the idea now. With 3. Now we have a couple of values that we can put into the position XYZ. And grid resolution is this one. Height map resolution. By the way, the height map resolution is 126. Although the actually height map is 128 pixels. 128 by 128 is the height map PNG, but our grid is only 126. That's because we don't sample the border because of these bugs that produce cracks. Yeah, okay, then let's attach the grid resolution here also. Hope this is the correct grid resolution. The world dimension. Yeah, I basically need all the parameters that we have already. And the height factor can be one. The height factor is this one, it's just like this is here you can make the displacement amount. And that we can also just put here. So, and now, yeah, now we get the collision data. Let's see. Now we should see bubbles. Yeah. There are bubbles, but they are not colliding properly. Okay, maybe let's go down a little bit here. Also, yeah, here's somehow it's weird when I want to go up and down, it goes up to minus and it goes down to towards plus. I don't know what's going on there, but I just stick to there. And I think the bubbles are moving a bit, but not correctly. Okay. Wait a second. This is maybe. Yeah, okay. Now it's almost there. Just need to put this down again a little bit. Maybe like this. Yeah. Yeah, now it's working. You have collision detection on the terrain and this is kind of not the thing that I expected here, but for the ones that we see it works. You see? Here it's kind of buggy, but so okay, so I would say not too bad. I was expecting that this would not work now in the example, but it works. But there are still some cracks and was everything put together a bit fast, this workshop file. Good, but it's getting somewhere also. Okay. And everything that we needed to do was basically these are the essential new nodes that we have to put in order, and then we have to put all the parameters. And that's it. Here, this terrain grid, scene file, element buffer, terrain collision is enough to make a us walk on the terrain theoretically, and practically also. Just that we still have some cracks and some weird things going on, but yeah. Is there any questions to that? Oh, and did I, now I lost everyone, or? Okay. Good. Then we could also see maybe, you know. Sorry? To make what from scratch? No, just anything or terrain related? Okay. Yeah. Maybe I can show the exporter files and examples that I prepared. Just for this terrain, for example. Now I have to open V4 again. This is the V4 example that exports this terrain that we saw in the previous V4.js example. It's basically just a Perlin noise, and the preview of the of the whole Perlin noise we see here. And there's this module heatmap batch renderer where you better don't have a look inside. It's just a messy logic for going over the grid like this and making a screenshot for every patch, terrain patch, yeah? So what happens when we make start rendering, it goes through and it makes every time a screenshot, and it exports also the JSON files for the collision detection, yeah, and that's basically all. And inside, there's nothing new happening. It's on the one hand there's this exporter logic, and on the other hand there's the writer logic, and some pipette and things like that. Yeah, and I mean. This is something you can experiment with. Let's say you want to make something like that, like a dynamic terrain or a dynamic heat map, then you can just use that. And here, I use only the R, the red channel in the texture. But in my other game prototype, you can I use the all channels of the texture, and you can do things like the red channel can be the height values, the blue channel can be the water height values, so you can do something like waterfalls, and the green channel can be something like vegetation distribution, or and the alpha channel you can also use for something like sampling from different texture atlases and different positions of the terrain. That's how they do it in game engines usually. And this is easily to be added to this example. Like, yeah. And then we have the maybe I show shortly the botany exporter. Also, so, so this is how the trees were made. I have a module that makes a L system. It's basically an old module from Sanj. The V4 user Sanj from years ago. He made once L systems, and I just reused it and yeah, make these trees with it. And actually, the only idea here is that this is for rendering. Doesn't interest us so much, but this exporter node, botany exporter, gets the transform values, and yeah, it's a long module that turns the transform values into separate into these four elements of the vertex attributes that we use later. You remember that this one transform consists out of four vertex attributes. That's just happening here in this patch, basically. Yeah, and it writes it all by hand, like all patched, like into a string. Because as we know, V4 is really nice for making our own string together, and a JSON file is really easy to put together with a patch. We don't even need special JSON parser nodes. It doesn't matter at all. You can add whatever you need. Here, for example, my characters have a bit more even than I need. I was just thinking, what can I use in the future? And I have things like character name, a random number that I could use for every character later without calculating it in life, and animation ID, animation offset. Frame count is, of course, important to know. A texture index is good if you sample from a texture atlas for all the different characters. So you can make a lot of different characters that have a lot of different textures by only using one texture, basically, by putting this index here. And then these matrix rows, they compose the transform matrix. Color and leaf position, which is the position of the billboards. Yeah. So what happens when I export one of these is, first I make randomized species, and it makes, this is basically what I mean with constraint-based procedural generation. You have the constraint basically make up the species of the blend, like there's a limitations where, from where to where the values go and this can be for multiple parameters, and they can be randomized separately. So, that's all to say here. It's kind of, I think it's not too hard. It's just a little bit different than what we're usually used to doing with VVV. What else do I have here? in the beginning, well, in the very beginning, I will show you a funny video. I was in the beginning doing everything with 2D because, why is it Thunderbird open? Who opened Thunderbird on my computer? I brought you this funny video because, 2 years ago, I was probably pretty stoned and had no money. And I was thinking, I need something to make a lot of money, and why not use V4 for procedural generating a large amount of Android apps and just drop it in the App Store every week. And I was thinking, I can probably put this together in 2 or 3 weeks. Should be easy. Then I have some money. And then 2 years later, it's still no game in the App Store. But I learned a lot about game development, and I also realized it's really not so easy as it seemed in the beginning. I even tried to make a crowdfunding, which I never published. And here I also have some stuff, some videos about this. This has nothing to do with it. In the beginning, everything was 2D, so I made this kind of Baldur's Gate 2, 2D isometric graphics with VVV, and used V4JS to play back these sprite-based animations and to make the background, and also I made experiments where you export background graphics and the dev values of the background graphics so that the 2D sprite can walk within the 2D background. It was also how they do it basically in this kind of Baldur's Gate 2 or something like that. And this way I ended up having a lot of sprite-based creatures. And And actually, at one point I was just thinking, shit, this 2D stuff is so... It kind of looks cool, but it's not very lively, because the game in 2D is not moving. You know, the background is always the same, trees are not moving, and things like that. And then I was just bored by it, and I started to make everything in 3D, and it took another year longer. But, that was the beginning for me. It's totally possible to do such things. And, you can just make this kind of constraint-based random exporters and make, like, tons of assets. I think this is a big strength of V4 that is completely underused. And with this this kind of tile-based exporters is also cool, because you can make up pretty big levels that load dynamically. Just need to make a logic that loads only the things that are within the visible frame, like within a few. Yeah, and this was really in the very beginning, like just experimenting with what can I produce in V4 and how does it look if it play back the sprites in V4JS. And there's no logic behind it, nothing. It was already a lot of fun. And I think even maybe not the 3D stuff is just too slow. The 3D stuff is more things like it's like some weirdo stuff. This is a crowdfunding that will never happen and would have never happened even if I started it. Okay, yeah, I think also now when you really want to make Android games, or I mean, games doesn't need to be necessarily these kind of classic games, but games can be also beautiful art, and especially in the media arts world where we are mostly come from, we can probably also push the meaning of games to another level and contextualize it eventually in installations and yeah. It was also my idea to get away from this classical Android game where you have constantly annoying pop-ups and you only play it if you're super bored or something. I was more like thinking the other way around, it could be also a way of artistic expression and like a way to make real artworks, which is usually hard with the I found it for my personally I found it really hard to get into real game engines, and it gets quickly much too much like mainstream game design for me, and with this I found a little bit a niche where you could still experiment and make interesting procedural generation that eventually can be turned into something like participatory art installations or something like that. Yeah. That was just the idea behind all of this, and in the end I was surprised myself that all this WebGL stuff evolved from it. I guess at one point I was stuck in the middle, and it was either you have to say okay, now it gets too complicated, and but then no one will ever do it eventually, or I wrap my head around it and have some nights without sleep and try to finish it, and yeah, still not 100% finished, but there is some stuff working. Other stuff is not working. For example, what we wanted to do for Node, but we couldn't finish it, is to enable the dev buffer in the renderer, like in DirectX 11. So that WebGL renderer also has a dev buffer output, and you can make post-processing like screen space, ambient occlusion, and shadows. Which is totally possible. We see such example already in 3.js a lot. And there's a lot of resources there. But this is also like still a little bit of work. And now I would like to come down a little bit, and everyone maybe can experiment around and we can discuss a little bit. And because I think it was already a lot, and I also don't want to talk about the collision detection engine. Now again, there's this example which doesn't 100% work. Maybe I, instead of trying to showcase it now, I will just first fix it, and then you can see the example on GitHub, and it will be easier than now trying to make it work, something like that. Okay. And any questions?
Such a lot of them.
But does someone have any questions now to one of the past examples? Or any questions? Sorry? Yeah. Many people ask already, but I still didn't manage to make a proper landing page and things like that, because I don't just want to give out the PDF, but I want to make it a proper thing. But then, yes. Yeah, just maybe you can follow me on, I don't know, where, Facebook, you will hear from it, Twitter, you will hear from it, Instagram, something like that.
Quite a bit of research in that field and trying to do from scratch.
Yes, absolutely. This is a super good question. Because it was very surprising for myself to start with this research because I encountered a whole field of scientific research into procedural content generation. There are a couple of universities and a small scientific community that make regular papers and conferences, and they are surprisingly, I would say they are one of the nicer field of computer graphic and information technologies that you can still read and you can still have some fun reading it, because it's a lot about things like research questions are, for example, how can I make a procedural content, a procedural generated level that contains the element of surprise? So they first have to find out what is, how is surprise be defined, and that is interesting. Things like you have interesting summary. What kind of algorithms exist there, yeah? And then what are they used for? For example, you have since the beginning of games and also movies, you have always terrain being a big topic. Especially in the 90s, you have these kind of fractal terrains from Mandelbrot. And other legendary terrain rendering people, and it's super interesting to read these papers from at that time, because they were so fascinated about fractals and how they can represent terrain or trees, like from Lindmeier, for example, L systems, and it's a good mix of interesting. Work out for the brain how to construct such a procedural tree or something, and reading people that are really fascinated from their work. It's really nice. I have the references here, and you can just look it up when you when I publish this.
Maybe you can add this to the or. Copy this to a text file and
just the references.
Yeah, and push it to.
That would be easy. Yeah.
To the network share or something.
If it would be a bit faster to scroll down. This is 200 references. Let's see if it works. Yeah, okay. It doesn't make sense.
Maybe a little desktop or something.
Yeah, it's not so easy. Then I go in the chapters, okay?
For the reference, like desktop, do the reference and put them on network share. So, most.
Yeah, but now they cannot do it so quickly because it's really much.
Yeah, sure.
But I would definitely recommend, for terrain, I would recommend reading the stuff from Musgrave. Yeah? I can just show this quickly, it's really fascinating paper. Yeah, here's this, this was 93, and he come up with all these nowadays so famous terrain models, like the ridged multifractal terrain is called, like, he combines different noise functions and comes up with such terrains. And yeah, these are the so-called multifractal terrains. That this term was defined from Musgrave, and they are really nice papers from Musgrave. And also Mandelbrot. There's this book from Mandelbrot from from 80 something, I don't know, it's called The Fractal Geometry of Nature. That book is definitely worth getting secondhand. I still try to get a copy that is not digital myself, because it's kind of really hard to get a cheap version of it. But it's a very big book with all the legendary people of Fractal Terrain, and they have all these really beautiful computer-generated graphics there. And blah 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 blah. And in terms of vegetation, I would recommend checking Oliver Deussen. It's a German professor that I actually worked at in the computer graphic department back in the university. And it's funny because at that time I was working in another context there, and I wasn't so much interested in vegetation rendering, but now that I made this research, I realized that he is actually the main guy behind the trees, I feel like that. And also, but I don't know if this book is in English, eventually. Then, yeah, definitely, absolutely worth checking out is the Rivas and Blau. This one, you know this film Star Trek, The Wrath of Khan, or Khan, or something like that? It's one of the early Star Trek. And they used, first time in cinema at that time, particle systems for making this planet explode or something like that. And the same research group that was doing the particles in this movie at that time also made amazingly beautiful vegetation and terrain renderings. And in when was this? 85. With so-called probabilistic lighting simulation. So they didn't even have real lighting models, not like this kind of Phong or Cooktorrens lighting, but they were doing probability-based lighting. So basically the idea of them was the leaves that are more outside of the tree, they get more sunlight, and the more it's inside, the less sunlight they get, and according to a probability value. And this way, they were able to render beautiful, realistic trees without any real lighting simulation. And yeah, that's only this picture, really? No, there's more here. Yeah. Genau, here, they were doing such renderings. And they were also, of course, not real-time. When they were rendering their graphics, they did basically what we do in V4 when you make the clear pin of the renderer off. It sticks always the last rendering inside, yeah? They were doing this from back to front with trees. Like first, very slow, the first tree, and then the second tree, and it takes really long, and every leaf has to have this probability correlation, and yeah, things like that. No, that was very interesting. And this is from Wrath of Khan, also their work. Yeah, and well, this paper is totally worth reading. It's called Rivas and Blau. Like this. And yeah, citizen buildings. They're all pretty interesting. There's this so-called agent-based procedural content generation in this context. And yeah, Ja. Ja. And for example, there's a paper from Lechner et al. That shows this agent-based procedural content generation. And it basically one software agent, which is like a separate program, makes the roads. And after that, another software agent goes through all the roads and places certain parts of the city. And then another agent makes like town, more like industrial areas. And the other agent makes the living quarters and things like that. And every agent is like a little software component that have also constraints and features that it must fulfill, like nearby the water, there shouldn't be so much industrial area, things like that. It's kind of super interesting. And oh yeah, many, many more things. I would say, if you're interested, just check out the thesis once I finally manage to make a landing page for it. Okay. Okay.
It also made me achieve that thing once you mentioned like such an old principles or those milestones. Is there anything like a timeline and there's been like breakpoints or something?
Ah, like a visual graphic for that?
No, I mean more like techniques you're doing these procedural things. Are there any milestones which change the way you do it?
For me personally, or some for in general for people in that at that time, yeah, there was something like that. There was especially in the research field, you could say in the beginning everyone was mostly focused on terrain and structural things like trees or buildings, and towards the millennium change, there was some researchers bringing up evolutionary algorithms towards these fields. So they first evolved these structures, yeah, and then there was a trend towards making it the animation, like walking characters to make them walk alone on terrain and things like that. And for that, they also utilized evolutionary computing. And then they found out they can use evolutionary computing to generate artificial neural networks. And that is the common hype. So where they're still heading towards some sort of peak that you can observe nowadays, where they are having interesting algorithms that make, for example, let's see if I find there's something, some term like neuroevolution of, yeah.
You said that you're currently working on a revision, but do you also plan to add some rigid body physics simulations later on?
Right now I don't have a use case, but maybe one day I will find it funny in the news.
There's a couple of artificial life simulations like that.
Yeah, I was also referencing them. Here. This is also an amazing paper from Carl Sims.
I do this a lot with new
trans space. That one is basically a rebuild of Carl Sims' original artificial creatures. The Carl Sims creatures look basically like this. They were just a couple of boxes, but with evolutionary algorithms, they evolved to walk on terrain, to swim, and to compete with each other for objects and things like that. And it's really nice. And what is this called again? What do you experiment? Frame sticks? Or?
Frame sticks,
Must
be 10 years ago when they currently develop it.
Yeah. I want to show a video that is similar to that, I think. It's basically every leg, or let's say every joint, is a separate neural network and gets evolved. And it's a primitive neural network that only consists out of a couple of nodes that make movement. Like, and both the morphology of the creature and the controlling neural network is evolutionary derived. And it has a physics engine inside. Yeah, it goes pretty long. I mean, there are really endless variation of walking cycles that we would never imagine. And swimming as well. I mean, something that you could totally think of that it's made in WeeWeeWeeWee. It's a bit more elegant than the walking. It's really cool. Yeah, and genau, that was that, and I wanted to find the...
By the way, I'm very interested to be
Ah ja, genau, das ist ein Lied. This one is the interesting thing that I found, the compositional pattern producing networks. It's a special kind of neural network that is producing patterns, and it looks pretty much like what we do with V4 by hand. Which is the funny part of it, so I was thinking this could be also... Yeah, there are this kind of... So the evolution algorithm basically removes and inserts different nodes, and those nodes are making different signal processing, basically. That's all. And with that it can make a large variety of motion. And or not only motion, but also images. There is this kind of thing they train the neural network to produce images of animals, which is also interesting, or all kind of images. And this one is especially nice. Because there is in the UK, one university concentrates on, has an institute for soft robotics. Yeah. They have this soft robotics lab, and there's a couple of nice publications that use the procedural generation and evolutionary computation to evolve morphologies for soft robotics with you have the muscle tissue. And a muscle tissue, a muscle 2 for expanding, and the other is for contracting, and you have bone for stability. And then it basically creates a voxel morphology from this. And by contracting and expanding the different muscles, these voxel things can walk. And right now they have simulated that, but I think they experiment also with manufacturing such robots by putting, for example, air. The expanding the muscles can be, for example, controlled by air pressure. Yeah, it's kind of super interesting. And here you see these evolutionary steps. It's really fast. It's nice, huh? And I mean, this is for soft robotics, but I was anyway finding it interesting in the context of procedural content generation for games. I was really writing a lot. There was after the research part about procedural content generation, there's also a theoretical part about games that use it, basically. So I was trying to give an overview and a categorization of the existing games that actually use procedural content generation. And yeah. Okay.
The characters we saw in your game, they weren't moving forward from their own physics.
No, that was just using inverse kinematic to make the legs look okay and the arms look okay.
Very close or attempted to try and automate the move by
vision? No, not really. I was trying to the more. Focus was just put a game prototype together, like, and then also to skip some details, because otherwise you have too much. It was already way too much.
They are pretty much inspired by this model.
It's funny because I first made the patches before I made the research part, so I was having it. It was not inspired from anything. Yeah. Yeah, okay, then I would finish here. Yeah.